Alright, so hello again everyone. This is episode 3 of the map review series brought to you by Engineer.tf. This week we'll be covering our first King of the Hill map in the series, Asheville. I'm Wax, and with me today is Exaflamer, who is a much more seasoned engineer than I am. He's been playing in Platinum for a few seasons, and he's been playing, Engineer for a lot longer than I have, definitely. And we also have Mothership on camera, so how are you doing, guys?
I'm doing well, thank
you. Very good.
Unfortunately, I don't play HL, like, anymore. Well, at least these past few seasons. But I might come back, eventually.
The knowledge is still there.
But yeah, I guess we can go over the callouts on this map.
Yeah. So let's go ahead and just go over the callouts first and foremost, just because it's a new map. So, yeah. First of all, this is spawn, and down here we've got lower lobby, and up here is ramp, this is blue roof, this is red roof, this is shutter, and up here is bats, this whole area, and down here is maze. And this is secret. Barrels. And finally, oh yeah, point. And finally, under.
Don't forget boiler room as well.
Oh my gosh, that. How did I forget boiler?
Also, like another like pretty good specific call is like this area right here. I generally like to call it fans. I don't know. Generally like the sniper like. A mini sentry gets placed here. It's just good to call that out, I guess.
Alright, so that's pretty much it for the callouts. It's a pretty small map, so there's not a whole lot to memorize. So, Exaflamer, as far as playing engineer on King of the Hill goes, what exactly is our main role?
I sort of alluded to that like earlier in the intro, but like typically like how I like to play is like I'm more of a combo-oriented engineer, so my positioning is like generally around the combo, like placing down a mini sentry near them and just trying to anticipate where the soldier is bombing on this map, because like on Asheville, like the soldier can get behind so easily, like he can just do like a pretty easy like high jump, like either off their bats and then onto your ramp area and like get your medic pretty easily, so typically I like to like put it like a mini like near ramp and just try like make sure like I'm being able to deny him from getting like any easy picks onto our combo. So like also like I said earlier, it's very easy for pretty much anyone to get onto your bats because they can just jump. Literally, you just jump onto your bats and get behind. So it's really important that you're not playing by yourself on bats. If you do, you generally want to like be working with your scout and soldier to make sure that you're clearing out this whole battlements area and making sure again that they don't get behind you guys. So it's more like engineer. I feel like it's more of like a gonna be playing the flank a lot, honestly, and just trying to make sure that their flank isn't like overpowering you guys, essentially.
All right. Yeah. Thanks. So that's pretty much it for your general role. A big one on this map is rolling out. So since rolling out on pretty much every side on this map is viable, so we're just gonna head back to spawn, Exa, and just show them our lovely, lovely viewers how to roll out on this map.
Right.
So, leaving spawn first. Tellies only cost 50 metal down, so don't really hesitate to just put one down. And there's three different ways you can roll out. You can go out through ramp, through shutter, and through bats. And there's advantages and disadvantages to every single one. So, but we're gonna just start with the most common one, which is through shutter. So, leaving shutter, or leaving spawn, put your tele entrance down. You put your exit down pretty much anywhere, since it's a Koth map, as long as it's safe, and which is pretty much everywhere on Asheville, honestly. And you just put a mini down right here in Shutter. Mm-hmm. And you just start wrangling out onto the point. You can wrangle up to the fans at Shutter, their barrels. And this is pretty much the most basic, effective rollout for Engineer on this map.
Right. Do you want me to explain how I roll out particularly?
Yeah, sure, go ahead.
Like, the Shutter rollout is good. Like, generally my default rollout is just to go to the left side, or not left side, the right side of our whole team and get whipped as well by the soldier. And I like to go through bats and then generally place like a mini right here. Because oftentimes what would happen is like the scout would like just easily get onto our bats, or the soldier likes to get behind from boiler and onto our Shutter or bats area. So I just try to like really anticipate them and like just try to get like a lockdown and that they're not gonna be getting a pick into a combo. So oftentimes what I've seen is like a soldier would just like bomb like anywhere around here just to get your sniper. So if you put a mini down here, you're just gonna be able to like shut him down pretty easily. So you have to be really wary though of the sniper sightline from their bats, because if you peek too much, you might get picked off. So I generally like to play like around this corner here and just like pretty much just push off our team's picks once we get it.
And finally, the last way to roll out is through ramp. So you just come in through spawn, through here or here, doesn't really matter. And this is probably the most passive rollout, since you're going to be putting your mini all the way back here. And what it will only really do is it'll stop people that are trying to immediately jump in from their bats into your lobby. And even then, since if you're the only one here, you're the only line of defense, it's pretty risky because you'll probably get killed.
Yeah.
So
that's a.
I don't really.
This is rollout that thing is just really risky. It's like, oftentimes like, the soldier's gonna be like you're gonna have to like 1v1 a soldier like immediately, and if you're spending like your whole mid fight just trying to kill that soldier, it's there's like benefits. Like, you're probably not gonna win that fight, first of all, unless you can manage to like get some meat shots off him, but most of the times you're gonna be like at a disadvantage fighting him here.
Right, so that's pretty much it for rolling out. So anyway, let's say your team has sort of managed to aggress the enemy team and you kept the point. What should you generally be doing, Exaflamer? Like, where should you be positioning yourself? Like, what are the ways you can position yourself to sort of play effectively?
Right. So, like, the important aspect about King of the Hill is that when you have the point, your respawn time is much longer than if you don't control the point. So, generally, we capture the point, like, my default move is just to immediately put, like, a dispenser around this ramp area, and then also to put like a teleporter like in boiler for our team, and then just like make sure I have all my buildings set up. And oftentimes what the other team will do is they're probably gonna be sending like in a lot of like sacrifice waves to try to like get any picks onto your combo or a team. So I mean, that's a reason why I don't like playing under, is because if you're playing under, you're not able to like put a mini and deny their bombs, because playing under is not gonna, it's like opposite from where your combo is holding. So I like just to like put like a mini around the roof area and just like control this whole area and just make sure that because this mini sentry right here is also able to deny the point while also gaining control of the whole rooftop. So, and I feel like this is such like a strong position to hold as well, because if you see like the sniper alone on their battlements, you can also jump the bats and like try to pick him off. And this flank right here that you can do is like so powerful, because if you work with your flank, you can essentially like be such a nuisance into their towards their team rather.
Would you recommend doing this like all the time? Like just jumping onto their bats and trying taking ground?
Well, you have to remember that like if you're too aggressive and you're just dying like all the time and overextending, you're just gonna be like essentially like not being like beneficial to your team, because again, once you die and you have possession of the point, you're just favoring them because they get to respawn faster and they're able to retake the ground that they lost. So I feel like if you know that your team is gonna lose possession of the point, then maybe it's a good idea to like just get behind them and like try to be like a distraction, or like try to get a pick before you guys lose the point. But oftentimes it's just best to be like conservative and just essentially play the point. Like because that's obviously what's gonna win you the game, is just playing the point and like letting the clock tick down. So by just being like just playing the objective really is like all you really have to do on this map. And just making sure that you're not dying like needlessly.
Playing under, like, are there any situations where playing under would be good? Like, let's say you didn't have the point, for example. Where would you want to be holding? Like, would be holding under a good idea to catch out low health players or something like that?
In particular, like, if you don't have the point and you're playing under, there's, like, a lot of good plays that you can set up, because oftentimes what you can do is, if your combo is, like, gonna be distracting up top, if you have a sentry down here, you essentially can lock down this whole area and make sure that their scout or whomever, like, isn't able to come down here and get access to this area. So if you're able to get control of this area, you can also oftentimes go into their maze area and get onto the bats, which is very good because you can get like a sniper pick or whatever. Like going.
I personally wouldn't recommend doing this every single life. Like you're hearing it now that it's a good idea, but remember that everything is situational because of right. Just how the way Highlander works, so that so people will always be positioning themselves in like just the strangest locations all the time. So I wouldn't really go down there unless you know for a fact that you can maybe have a teammate distract from your roof and cause some sort of havoc so that you can flank in and maybe get an important pick.
Right, and the good thing about having or like just positioning yourself under is if your team pushes up top, like let's say you guys do an Uber exchange, you can generally pinch the other team because it's essentially like a war on two fronts at the point, because they have to worry about what's in front of them while also worrying about under, because you could put like a mini right here, and while their whole team is all distracted looking like forwards, you could put like a mini right here and just like pick them off while they're not looking at you. So that's like a very good flank play that I like to do. And another like trick you can do is like if there's like a soldier like holding on like this area right here, if you hug the wall, you can generally like get like a couple shots without getting hit because of like how this incline is at. So just like using this like angle is really good.
Alright, so what if you were to, let's say you had a more more passive play style as an engineer, where would you want to be positioning yourself if your team didn't have the point? Like, let's say their flank was a consistent problem, for example. Where would you want to be positioning yourself in a way that can consistently shut down, or help shut down their flank, if you didn't have the point?
Oh, if you didn't have the point, okay.
Yeah.
So in that situation, I feel like there's generally like a couple of things you can do. So Well, first and foremost, I generally like to play Shudder and just wrangle my gun. And then essentially, if you wrangle, you can like just be like a nuisance onto your team as well. And if your team calls that there's a scout and soldier on your bats, it's good to work with your flank, and you can rotate from here onto the bats and sort of catch any anyone that's on here. Because obviously this whole area right here is just gonna be dominated by the flank. Like, that's probably the first place that I would normally see like any flank member at. So oftentimes, like, it's just really about working with your flank. Like, if you're not gonna 1v3 their team as engineer. Maybe you can, but it's really just
Unless you're
about working with your flank.
if you're not Skag, it probably won't be happening very often.
Yeah, so what you could do is like have your scout and soldier, or just anyone really, call that there's someone on your bats, right? And then you just want to rotate and just work with your flank and clear out bats, and then with that man advantage down, then it just makes like pushing a lot easier because their flank is down.
So let's say your flank is down and their flank is aggressing. Like, let's say you're down, like your scout and your soldier, and it's just you. Should you try? Is it worth trying to take a 2v1 or a 1v1 in order to get them off your bats? Or is it better to just sort of stay back and wait for your spawns?
Okay, so you're obviously not in possession of the point, and they're overextending. So if you feel that you have reliable DM and you're able to get like a kill on like any of their flank members, that's already like an advantage for your team, because like I said, they're gonna get like a longer respawn time. So even if you manage to get like a pick on their soldier, like that's already favoring your team, because I feel like dying on King of the Hill while not having positioned the point is, you're able to afford that, honestly. Like you're able to go for those exchanges, because at the end it's not gonna really hurt you because you're just gonna respawn like really fast. So I would say like you should, in those situations, it wouldn't be like a terribly like bad idea to go for that fight.
All right. So, would you say that pretty much about covers it for your basic overview on like your role on Asheville, like what you do in general? Like when you're pushing, when you're holding, that sort of thing. Think we've covered all the bases, because there is one somewhat important question that I do want to get to. So like, do you think there's any additional information that would be worth
Something
covering?
like, well, like I'm just gonna keep emphasizing, like, this is obviously like a very strong DM map, so like I would just focus on not taking like very dumb fights and just being a smart player with your positioning and just making sure that you're working well with your team and not getting constantly picked off by their flank. Like, if you can do that, then I would say that you're doing your role on this map as engineer.
All right.
Yeah.
And the final question, I guess this is a pretty big one because I see a lot of engineers do this sort of thing in pugs and lobbies, even in official scrims and matches. What do you think about running level 3s on Asheville? Because it's been shown several times that a level 3 in Shudder is definitely a force to be reckoned with.
Right. Okay, so this sort of dates back to like, and there has been like a lot of success with level 3s on Shudder. Like, I believe like Josh and like Ender ran it back in their grand finals matches, and it has shown to work pretty well, because just a mere fact that if you have a level 3 in the Shudder door and it's also wrangled, like they have to like use so many resources just to take it down. So like they have to send in a spy to sap it while also having their Dummo spam the shutter door with his stickies. So like if you want to like hold the point for like a very long time, I feel like this is a strat that could really work well if they're not expecting like a gun to be here, because obviously what you can do is like you leave the shutter door closed, and then once you know that they're on the point or they're Ubering in, you can just open the shutter door and have it wrangled and just like be like a huge distraction while your combo regroups and like and pushes in to either like milking your Uber or etc. So like yeah, I wouldn't consider running it full time, because like I've said, like if you're running it full time, the soldier knows that you're here, the spy knows that you're here, like, and it's just gonna be so predictable that all the soldier has to do is just jump on your bats and then spam like a couple of rockets like from this angle right here and just like kill you easily. And I don't think it's gonna be really like that much of a annoyance to their flank, because it's only watching like really one angle, which is like the point. So, and oftentimes you're probably gonna be running the Rescue Ranger, so in terms of DM, like you're gonna be losing like those fights against the scout and soldier if you just ran like mini sentries and shotgun. So like to really wrap it all up, I think I wouldn't run it like all the time, like maybe once or twice just to like catch them off guard essentially.
All right, so thanks. So overall, what are your like thoughts on Asheville as a both an engineer map and a Highlander map? Just a, sort of like a brief summary of what you think of Asheville.
Right, so like in regards like to other maps like Product and Lakeside, like just because of like how the structure and dynamic of the map is, like the scout and soldier are near almost like always top fragging on this map, because it's just so easy for them to get fragged. So it's just that more important that especially like engineers either shutting them down or also like helping your flank out to just be a thorn to the team. So I feel like DM is much more important on this map than other maps or other COF maps in particular. So it's a, like I said, like you're gonna need to be just working with your like your flank a lot if you wanna be pretty successful in like shutting them down. Like if you're not working well with your flank, I don't think you're gonna have a very fun time on this map.
Alright.
Yeah.
So I guess that about wraps it up, for this map at least.
Actually, I think we have some questions actually from the Twitch chat. So the first one I got on my list is level 3 is under the point. This is a highly requested item by many people.
Level 3 is under the point.
They're just memeing. That's epic.
Okay, so I mean if you want to turtle under and just like, okay, so let's say you do play level 3 under the point, like all they have to do is just play up top, and then that whole play is like not even like viable anymore. Because maybe if the point was under and not the other way around, then it would work, but they just have to play up top and just win, honestly. Because having control of under is not important, I wouldn't say.
Against a coordinated team, that pretty much spells disaster for you or for your and your gun, so I'd imagine it would only work well in like a pug scenario.
Honestly, like I would rather put level 3 on the roof, because that's just more annoying for their whole team.
It's a worse mini sentry.
Yeah. Because if you put level 3 on the roof, their soldier cannot bomb your medic whatsoever if you wanted to play that.
Okay, so the next question I have on my list is dealing with spies.
Oh, okay. Yeah, so... I mean, generally the spies... Well, it depends on his playstyle. If he wants to focus your buildings the whole game, and like... And if you're running level 3s, he's gonna focus you that much more, so... And... So for like the level 3 strat, if you put a gun on in a shutter door, you're gonna have to be looking around just a lot, like... Just make sure that you're just constantly like rotating. And like the spy likes to decloak in this like corner right here and pick you off while you're wrangled and not looking at him. So just remember that if you're running level 3s, the spy is gonna most likely like go for a play on you. But in regards to like just general like spy detection and like just making sure that you're not getting picked off by him, it really... I think you should just make a habit to just always like rotate and just look around like a lot, because that's what I do. I just, out of habit, I always look behind and listen to like decloaks and stuff with your headphones.
Personally, I think that should you choose to run level 3s, I'd use shotgun instead of Rescue Ranger if you think spies will really be that much of a hassle. And the best part is a lot of players won't really expect you to be running a shotgun with a level 3. They'll just assume that you'll be on Rescue Ranger, so yeah, maybe it can be a good surprise factor, but again, shotgun is really, really useful.
Yeah, I feel if you're going to be running level 3s, like shotgun is a very safe weapon to use. But if you want to get like more like ballsy and go for like, plays like that, you can definitely use a Rescue Ranger, but you're just gonna be sacrificing potential DM output of that. If the soldier or scout decides to 1v1 you, it's gonna be much harder to engage in that fight.
Alright, are there any other notable questions?
So the last notable question, and this is kind of a combined one, and this is dealing with, the original question was Widowmaker on this map, but I probably can expand it out to Panic Attack as well as maybe Frontier Justice as well.
I can answer this one. This one's very situational. Personally, I would never recommend running Widowmaker, specifically on this map, just due to how useful the Wrangler is. Like, how the Widowmaker works is if you... you probably know how the Widowmaker works. The damage you do is returned as metal. But, if you don't have any more metal, like, let's say you run out of ammo, you'll have to rely on only your melee if you're running the Wrangler, and you're pretty much a sitting duck at that point. So, Widowmaker, in my opinion, is out of the picture, just due to how useful the Wrangler can be. As for Panic Attack, this one's kind of gimmicky, and if you really want to use it, I guess you can try and use it as like a sack sort of weapon. Like you can just jump down from roof and try and force the medic or something because of the burst damage. And as for Frontier Justice, that's been said, this one's been said time and time again that it should really only be run if your gun... after you've died, and let's say you're respawning, and your gun already has a good amount of kills and assists on it. I usually just go with at least 3. But again, like, you're really limiting your firepower because you only have 3 shots instead of the normal 6.
I want to add on to your Widowmaker position.
Oh, yeah, sure, go ahead.
Like, if you're running Widowmaker, you're just really... losing your ability to make a lot of sentries, because if you fire a shot, like...
Oh yeah, and buildings in general.
You're just losing potential, like, output of sentries, and that's just such a good... many sentries are just so good on this map. You always want to have one up, at least just somewhere watching the angle. Like, I feel like that's much more important than using a gun. And in regards to like when you would use it, it's very situational. Like, I would probably only use it if there's like 10 seconds left on the clock and I just want to dive on the point and just spam my shotgun, get kills or something.
Yeah, and going back to Frontier Justice, yeah, I'd really only ever recommend running it if you already your gun already had a few kills and assists on it that would give you a decent amount of crits. And also, those crits aren't always useful because they will do lots of damage, implying you can like hit a solid shot. Because you'll probably be doing like around 120 damage will be like an average unless you're hitting meat shots consistently, which is 180, which is nice, but. That's another gimmick, I guess. If you want to run it full time, I mean, nobody's stopping you, but you really are sort of putting yourself at a disadvantage in the long run. So is that the last?
And this is the last question. This wasn't really asked, but I'm going to ask it for my, just because. So notable sentry spots on this map. That's one thing you guys didn't really talk about.
Oh, yeah.
For minis, at least.
So the one in Shutter is like the classic one. Like this is the big one. It's a popular one on rollout. You just come out here, wrangle it, covers a ton of area. Another big one, as X has said, was right around here on rollout. This one on fans is really annoying because you can you just wrangle across the entire point from down here. You just have your back against the wall. You can also just be up there if you really want to. Another big one is on roof. I cannot get up here. On roof is a big one. Because it can watch bats, it watches the exit to shutter, and you can wrangle it so that it can watch your gun so that it can watch ramp. But you do have to be careful of sniper sightlines and such. You can also go down here. Pretty much anywhere down here works because it watches almost the entirety of under, no matter where you put it. So that's viable enough. That's pretty much it, honestly. You can also just put it right outside shutter, so that you don't have to like open it every time to shoot it at somebody. I personally like to do this, but you can. It's honestly up to you. And that's pretty much it for sentry spots.
I want to talk about. Do you want to talk about dispenser spots? If that's.
Oh yeah, go for it.
Like this.
There's only like a few.
Like the dispenser spot on ramp is just so good because your medic can hide in it, and if a soldier bombs your medic, he can essentially use it as a shield and stay alive.
And you can also still get onto roof just by jumping onto that little sheet there, and then there you go. So yeah, that's pretty much it for Asheville. It just definitely dragged on a lot longer than I was originally expecting, but I think we did cover a lot of ground and got a lot of covered a lot of bases. So thanks for tuning in, and we'll see you next week for Broadout.